Never let them see you sweat. Never let them see you sweat. Never let them see you sweat.
Tribe FM and Never Let Them See You Sweat Go West. And now we are absolutely privileged to be talking to a four times Grammy Award winner right across the lands. We're talking to Kuk Harrell. How are you?
I'm excellent. How are you guys doing? Thanks so much for having me on. I really appreciate it.
Oh, no, thank you for coming on. It's, as I said, it's an absolute privilege. Now, you're born in Chicago?
Yep, born in Chicago, born and raised in Chicago, grew up in the south suburbs, like 30 minutes outside of Chicago, lived in Chicago proper for a long time.
Yeah. Now, tell us a little bit about your upbringing with your folks. Are they musical?
Yeah, my mother and her two sisters, they were part of a, they were actually the first black background singers to sing on radio and TV commercials in advertising back in Chicago, and that subsequently led them to working with people like Curtis Mayfield, the Ohio Players, Earth, Wind & Fire, Aretha Franklin. So they were pretty in the music industry in that sense. And then cousin, we grew up with watching them and desired to do the same thing. So we actually went into doing radio and TV commercials, and then after that decided we wanted to do records. So.
No, that's fantastic. Yeah. Now you've worked with there's nobody you haven't worked with. You just must pinch yourself every day, going, "What a wonderful life you have." I mean, who's the next big thing? I just wanted to ask you this: if you got someone that you're cooking up in the studio at the moment that we're all going to be hearing about in the next few months?
Yeah, the next few months I'm going to be hearing a lot from. A lot more from Jennifer Lopez. You're going to be hearing a lot more from Cher. That's the next thing I've got going. And there's another new artist. A new artist, her name is Madison Beer. She's a part of Scooter Braun's camp. Scooter is the manager and discoverer of Justin Bieber.
Okay.
So he has a new artist. Her name is Madison Beer. She's absolutely amazing. So you're going to be hearing a lot from her. I've been in the studio a lot with her, super.
Right, excellent. Now, we've got a bit of a local connection with you because we have Sia is a local Adelaide girl who, Diamonds in the Sky. When someone puts a song forward to you, how much collaboration or did you consult the songwriter in a lot of the sense, or is it basically, give me the song and I'll make it a hit? How do you work it?
What happens is they actually, not to take anything away from them, because the writers, because they come up with the hit, but they send the demo in, and basically I follow the blueprint that they have there, and then take that and then just put the artist on it. And then I polish it up and shine it and I basically follow the passion that they have, but I take that passion to the next level. And what the next level is literally connecting the artist to that record.
Yep. And also, I mean, obviously, you're in the studio, you're creating the records, and then you're getting it out. You also get involved with the actual when the artist is doing their show. You must. How much attention do you pay to those live shows? Are you right in there actually trying to work out how to recreate that sound in a live sense as well? Do you have a lot of say in that?
It's funny because at first my position was strictly in the studio, and then for a little while when Justin Bieber first started going out on the road, I was out with him just for a little bit, just so that we could, because he was young, just so we could bridge the gap between studio and live and live. And then he's got that on his own now, so I don't go out with Justin anymore, but with Jennifer Lopez, this was her first world tour, so with that, I actually went out with Jennifer for that entire tour, and it was so amazing because she and I worked together every single night before the show and during the show to make sure that we translated the record live. So it was a really cool process that we came up with, and I'd just be there for her, and on the show, I was always like right out front, she could see me, and she could just see me, and just having a smile on my face going, yeah, that gave her the sense that she was in the studio, and we were going back and forth, that was actually producing her in the studio, gave her that comfort level.
I mean, I always find it fascinating to see how someone like J-Lo will actually have such an energetic performance, and also keep a vocal, the credibility in the vocal. Is it sometimes a matter of, you know, having few vocal, like a few overdubs that to in those really energetic parts, or is it someone like J-Lo, is she just straight out the whole way, just singing the whole time?
No, well, for, it's not Jennifer, but, and it's not, the way I do it, it's not having stuff that's already overdubbed or anything like that. It's using the tools that we have. So obviously you have background singers on the show, or, you know, live background singers in the show. So it's actually creating and doing an arrangement of the song to where the person, singing, the artist, they're supported. So in places where they're dancing a lot, moving them around, you would normally hear them singing, you can have them kind of bring back their singing, but have the background singers take over.
Okay.
And really just carry that part. So when they when the artist comes back in, it's not so different. It doesn't seem like a surprise, or you don't miss the part that they actually put there.
Yeah, because, I mean, the just that physical presence that they must have to keep on stage. You're just, they're athletes as much as anything,
absolutely,
aren't they? It's fantastic. Now, tell us a little bit about your own writing and that. Do you, what's a song, what would you say your proudest song? Have you got one that you really loved being involved with and love writing in particular?
Without question, that first record would be, there's a lot of them, but that first record that I'm really proud of would be Umbrella, Rihanna's Umbrella, because I co-wrote that with Tricky Stewart and The Dream, and that record was my first, that was all three of ours' first mega hit, and that was my first hit. Like, Tricky had hits before, Dream had a couple of hits before, but that was my legitimate first hit. And that record changed our lives. So by far, is the proud of that record. And then went on to be the same thing with Single Ladies.
Yep.
And then just records after that I was a part of with all the other artists that I've worked with, like the vocals that I've produced, the albums that I've produced for Justin, and the albums that I've produced for Rihanna after Umbrella, and Jennifer, the hit, you know, On the Floor. So.
Now,
a lot of records, but Umbrella would be the one record that I'm most proud of.
Now, I mean, obviously, you're basically, you know, the premier, well, one of the premier, you know, vocal producers in the world. How do you get that performance out of the artist? Is it, you know, do you find yourself in a sense being a bit of a coach? You know, how much of it is the artist talent, and how much of it is, you know, waiting for that right performance? Is it is that a tricky thing?
You know, it's honestly a beautiful thing, because and I know I can't say it this way, it's not 50-50, but in a lot of cases it's 50-50, but I'll say it's 50-50 in the sense of it's how we come together. Because when you're working with a superstar, the most important thing is giving them the opportunity to be themselves, and then all I'm here to do is just capture who they are.
Yeah.
The flip, wrong part of that, or the wrong way of doing that, is having the artist come in and trying to make them sound like me as a producer.
Right.
So in that case, it's just a matter of letting them be them, so letting them be the artist, letting them have their sound, and then I just shape it and mold it, and we're making it sound like the record that we're supposed to be doing. But really, I'm just shaping and molding and letting them and capturing their personality.
Now, how often do you have to say, oh, come on, well, maybe we'll just turn off the desk today and come back tomorrow? Is there many moments like that?
You know what? That doesn't happen too much because of who I'm working with, meaning, it's like that much. And any time it does happen, it has nothing to do with their vocal ability or anything like that. It just happens to be that maybe it just wasn't a good day. Like, you know, the superstars, they have a lot going on during the day before they come to the studio. So the studio is the time where they usually have to unwind first before we actually start recording. And sometimes, because of maybe if really busy day. They probably, sometimes they don't get an opportunity to really, really unwind. And then we just go, you know what? We just come back tomorrow. You'll be fresh, and then we'll kill it. And it always works out right. They come back and they're fresh, and we just knock it out. Because it doesn't take us long at all to cut the vocals that we do.
We're talking to Kuk Harrell, and we're talking about all things. The thing that I think about as someone in your position is that you're actually, you know, you're creating, you know, the stories of a generation. Do you often sit back and go, hold it, you know, I mean, I was just looking at the numbers just from your first your Red Zone. You know, I mean, Red Zone was just in the, you know, back in the day, responsible for 25 million album sales. I mean, you go, wow, you think about all that's gone on since then, you know, that you are directly influencing, you know, the youngsters and all ages across the world. You know, you're participating in culture in a massive way. Does that overwhelm you at times, or do you just take that as part of the job?
You know what? It does not overwhelm me at all. It's a part of the job. It excites me more than anything because I worked a long time. And but as you kid, you grow up and you hope and wish that you could get into a position to where you are considered the best. And you know, I think last week I saw that. I went, wow, I really worked a long time, and I always used to hope and pray that I would get to this point, and I'm actually there now, and it just makes me happy. It doesn't get overwhelming because I really don't look at it that way. I don't look at it in the sense of it's a huge responsibility. It's a part of the job. It excites me, and the big thing that it does, it puts me in a position where I want to just be able to pour the knowledge that I've gained and the expertise and all that into the generation that I'm actually influencing, the up-and-coming artists and writers, which is what led me to do Who's Next.
The thing I was going to talk about was, you know, your relationship with God, because I noticed you were the vocal director for the Promise Keepers, Peacekeepers, is that right?
Yep.
Yeah.
Promise Keepers.
Tell us a little bit about that. You know, the gospel connections and maybe your upbringing and where do you sit with that? Are you involved with a special church or anything like that?
Yeah, I grew up in church. My grandfather was a pastor. Grew up in church. Like everybody does growing up, you go to church because you have to, because your family goes. And I think when I was about 13, I stopped going, you know. And then later on in life, this I would probably say maybe 10 or 15 years before, and to have my own relationship with God. And when I moved to California and started going to a church called Christian Assembly here in Eagle Rock, California. And I developed my own relationship with God, and I think that actually happened after I had taken a break from the music industry because I felt like I needed something more to happen in my life. And what that relationship with God did was it taught me who I was first and foremost, and what I was gifted to do. And then once I got solidified in that, that led me to be who I am in the industry right now, because I do everything out of passion, you know. In working with all these artists, I do it out of not to make a lot of money, but to just because I'm passionate about it, I'm gifted at it, and I love it. And I know that music changes people's lives, and I'm happy that my relationship with God brought me to the revelation to be able to do that with people.
We're talking to Kuk Harrell, and we're going to be playing a song just fine from Mary J. Blige. Mary J. Blige. My pronunciation at times, I'll tell you, Kuk. Anyhow, we're going to play this tune. Can you tell us a little bit about this track, or Just Fine? Do you recall the story around that?
The Mary J. Blige Just Fine record?
Yep, that's right.
Yeah, that was done, man. I can't remember the year it was done, but that was the first song I ever produced on Mary J. Blige, and It was amazing. That was one of my first Grammys that I won for that album. And I'm based in Atlanta. We were in Atlanta. Mary and her manager, her two managers, came down to Atlanta. I met her. We got in. She loved the track. And I was like, "You ready, Mary?" And she's like, "Yep, let's do it." She jumped in the booth, and we just knocked it out probably within an hour or so.
Right, that's awesome. I mean, after four Grammys, do you sort of go, "Oh, not another Grammy?" Or do they just get better and better? Or, you must, you enjoy the, I mean, the awards are personally satisfying, or do you look at it more as a collective group, you know, part of your, how many people do you have working for, do you have a group there working for you, or you're pretty much a sole trader? Do you work on your own, or you've got a whole network with you?
In what fashion, in the writing or the production?
In the production, is there a lot of people involved, or is it pretty much you?
Well, in the vocal production phase of it, I'm sorry if I'm missing something, but the connection was weird. But the vocal production mode is pretty much just me creatively. Like, yeah. I headed up, and I have my engineer, Josh Goodwin, who works with me, and we just get in here and just cut. Like, I'll cut the vocals, I'll produce the vocals, then I'll comp the vocal, I'll clean it up, and then I'll let him do a rough mix and all that kind of stuff, and we just go from there.
Fantastic.
But the other producers, the producers that wrote the word are mainly involved. So I'll get everything done, and then I'll send the files back to them, and they'll do all the finishing touches.
Okay, let's have a listen to Just Fine, and we'll be back with Kuk Harrell in just a minute.
You know I love music. And every time I hear something hot, it makes me want to move. I have fun. But it's something about this joint right here. This, it makes me want to...
Oh! Let it go. Can't let this thing called love get away from you. Feel free right now, go do what you want to do. Can't let nobody take it away from you, from me, from we. No time for moping around, are you kidding? And no time for negative vibes, cause I'm winning. It's been a long week, I put in my heart. It's gonna live my life, feel so good to get it right. So I like what I see when I'm looking at me, when I'm walking past the mirror. Don't stress through the night at a time in my life. Ain't worry about if you feel it. Got my head on straight, I got the vibe right. I ain't gonna let you kill it. See, I won't change my life. The best out of life, treat yourself to something new. Keep your head up high and yourself believe in you, believe me. Having a really good time, I'm not complaining. And I'ma still wear a smile if it's raining. I gotta enjoy myself regardless. I appreciate life, I'm so well satisfied. So I like what I see when I'm looking at me, when I'm walking past the mirror. What you gonna do? I'm a lady, so I must stay classy. Gotta keep it high, keep it together if I want to get better. See, I won't change my life.
when I'm walking past the mirror. Don't stress through the night at a time in my life. Ain't worried about what you feeling. Got my head on straight, I got the vibe right. I ain't gonna let you kill it. See, I won't change my life just by
And that was Mary J. Blige with Just Fine. And we're talking to Kuk Harrell all the way across the waters. Now, tell us a little bit of that. You had the you co-wrote the theme song for Avatar. Now, that was an amazing movie.
Yes.
Who did you co-write that with?
I co-wrote that with Jane Horner, the orchestrator and movie guy, and Simon Franklin from London. That was such an amazing opportunity to be able to get to write, be a co-writer on that song for the biggest movie of all time.
And it was awesome. It was all on the edge of our seats, and it's really got a big new wave of 3D happening, isn't it, really, throughout all the cinema. Well, now, what was your first movie soundtrack? Was it Go West? Was, you know, when you, White Man Can't Jump? Was that your sort of first major?
White Man Can't Jump.
I was just saying, was that your first sort of major breakthrough when it came to films and soundtracks?
Yes, Avatar was, and then the first movie ever it did a song, it was White Man Can't Jump. Man, that was back in the 80s, I think.
Yeah, right. Yes, now you're 48. You look like you're 28.
I wish.
You're looking good, mister. Now tell us a little bit about Sugar Wooga.
That I do all of my vocal production through, and also I have Sugar Wooga Entertainment, which is the company that I really have a heart for young up and coming artists. And that's the company that I do imprint deals with through major labels to sign young artists to.
Okay, excellent. So how many did you bring? Did you mentor a lot of producers coming through from your local area as well?
You know, I do maybe one or two co-produce with me, but like when I'm doing the music for stuff, but. Artist-wise, I really mentor a lot of up-and-coming singers because I know what it takes to do this thing, be an artist. I know what these artists have to go through and the things that they...
And we've dropped that line a little bit at the moment. Are you there? I think we've dropped out. Are you back, Kurt? No, I think
we'll set it up again. We're going to play Diamonds.
Okay, we're going to play Diamonds in Sky, which is written by a local girl here. Oh, we're back. We're back. We lost you for a moment there. We're just talking about Sugar Wooga. So when it comes to, we had a young band on a couple of weeks ago called the Savannah Van Band. Those are lovely young kids. Tell us a little bit about them. Are they in your local area?
Yes, they're. Yeah. They're for the Savannah Band. First and foremost, I'm going to tell you guys thank you so much for supporting them. They are a band that I discovered like 3 years ago and really have been taking them through the artist development process, teaching them, you know, just teaching them how to turn their music into just great hooky pop records, and teaching them how to go into the studio and record the stuff on their own, produce it on their own, teaching them how to, you know, be artists and do interviews and all that kind of stuff, so that when things pop off of them as superstar artists, they're prepared. That's you just need to be prepared for when it happens.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, so now with the American Idol stuff, is there no bet? I mean, it, when this sort of reality TV slash, you know, build a star, you know, came into vogue, is this the best way of actually promoting a new artist to the masses? Is it something that's not going to tire, this type of, you know, the American Idol thing?
You mean American Idol? No, I think American Idol is, you know, for what it is, it's definitely a top voter. American Idol hits the world.
Yeah.
You know, it's worldwide. But I think that there's, you know, I'm working on something that I think there's another way of doing it. So, I mean, that's all I'll say about it. But it's, you know, it's a great way because American Idol hits the world. But there is another way to hit the world, and there's another way to give people a shot. I think there's more than just one way of doing it.
Well, it was interesting. I was reading back through, you know, through the history a bit, and you recording with J-Lo and Jay-Z was one of the highest selling digital. At the time, it was the highest selling digital song, and that was sort of ushering in. That was 2003, and the sort of ushered in this new world of you know, the download. And how much did that give more strength to the artist? How have you read it now? It's 10 years down the track. Where do you see this new revolution?
I'm sorry, say that one more time. It was breaking up.
I was just going to say, after 2003 with Jay-Z and J-Lo doing the collaboration, which you actually won a Grammy for, 10 years down the track, seeming that was a massive online digital seller, how do you see it now? Is the artist in a better position now than it was 10 years ago? Seeming they can sort of directly market there to the world, with, you know, maybe bypassing the record companies. How do you see it?
I think they do. It does put the artist in a better position. I mean, you're absolutely right about that. But unfortunately, you know, fortunately for the labels, but unfortunately for the independent artists, they really, you know, there's a possibility. But a system, and that's with anything. But you know, once they sign to the major, they could get caught in the system and really maybe not even get an opportunity to hit the world. So for the independent artist, and we see this every day with people that are just uploading videos to YouTube and they're releasing them themselves. So it's a great thing. I've been saying lately that the playing field is actually really level because, you know, a guy that's signed to a major label has the, a guy that isn't signed to a major label has that's signed to a major, and in some cases has a better shot because he doesn't have a whole machine that has to be cohesive before his music can get uploaded to iTunes and digital distributors around the world.
And obviously, like, the physical distribution of CDs back in the day was an incredibly costly thing and a huge gamble too. And a lot of the artists used to wear that cost. Even if they were signed to a record company, they'd still wear that cost. So nowadays, you bypass that risk, which is a good thing.
Absolutely. That's why it's really important. Somebody really knows how to pick an artist. You know, if you're able to pick an artist, then you can really win just like the majors can, you know, because you can make it available to the world immediately.
Now, if you're out there listening and you're going, I am the next big thing, how do people get involved? Do you just allow people to send you stuff and for you to have a listen to? And
What I've started is a worldwide internet talent search called Kuk Harrell's Who's Next. And what the whole thing about that is people get to shoot a video of themselves, upload it to their YouTube channel, hit me on Twitter with the hashtag Who's Next, and then I actually go look at their video, and then I can I contact them and give them insight into, yeah, you sound really good as a singer, but you should do this, change this up, do this, shoot the video again, and let me see that. They go through the whole process again, and what it is I'm actually giving people artist development online. Like, yeah. They don't have to go anywhere. They don't have to stand in line and do it. Anything. It was just videotape themselves with their phone, their raw singing, and send it to me, and I hit them right away.
That is awesome. It's great that you allow yourself to be open to anyone, to give them an opportunity. It has been... I can't even put it in words. Well, yes, I can put it in words. It's been an absolute pleasure and an honour having a chat to you today here on Tribe FM. And, you know, come to Australia and come and see us if you get a chance.
I definitely will.
We'll go.
And thank you. Thank you so much for having me. I really appreciate it.
Oh, no, the pleasure is all ours. Now, we're going to go out with Rihanna with Diamonds in the Sky. As I said, we got the local Sia, who is the songwriter for this song. So it's a bit of a local connection. So it's great to tie up with you, Kuk. And all the best for the future. And we'd love to chat to you again. If we can chat to you somewhere down the track. It would be, as I said, once again, an absolute pleasure. So thank you very much.
Thank you. You're welcome. And I can't looking forward to coming there and seeing you guys.
All right, mate. Good on you. Thank you. See ya.
All right. Bye-bye.
Shine bright like a diamond. Shine bright like a diamond. Fine light in the beautiful sea. I chose to be happy. We're like diamonds in the sky. You're a shooting star I see. A vision of ecstasy. When you hold me, I'm alive. We're like diamonds in the sky. I knew there would become one right away. Oh, right away. At first sight I felt the energy. We're beautiful like diamonds in the sky.
Shine bright like a diamond. Shine bright like a diamond. Shine bright like a diamond.
We're beautiful like diamonds in the sky.
Shine bright like a diamond. Shine bright like a diamond. Shine bright like a diamond.
We're beautiful like diamonds in the sky.
Palms rise to the universe as we moonshine and my lady. We're like diamonds in the sky.
You're a shooting star I see. A vision of ecstasy. When you hold me, I'm alive. We're like diamonds in the sky. At first sight I felt the energy of something. I saw the life inside you. Shine bright tonight. You and I. We're beautiful like diamonds in the sky. Eye to eye, so alive. We're beautiful like diamonds in the sky.
Shine bright like a diamond. Shine bright like a diamond. Shine bright like a diamond.
We're beautiful like diamonds in the sky.
Shine bright like a diamond.
Shine bright like a diamond.
Shine bright like a diamond.
Shine bright like a diamond. So shine bright.